Everything, Officer Zilla. Everything is wrong! COPPA is what's wrong! It's an update to a stupid law the United States is enforcing. Something about child protection online. Now YouTube's making creators choose how to mark their videos. One option is to say your video was made for kids, and another is to say your video isn't for kids. I don't have any other choice, but it's going to have a massive impact on the ship's channel. I probably won't ever get to realistically monetize any videos I make, so feeding the crew is off the table. And even if I wanted to continue this channel as a hobby or a passion project, I still won't get nearly as much exposure if my videos are marked as for kids. People won't be able to add our videos to their watch later list, subscribers won't get notifications when I upload, and the other shipmates won't even be able to leave comments. What's the point in sharing my opinion if nobody's there to listen or engage? It feels like the ship finally started sailing, but now it's got a huge hole in its side. I don't know, Officer Zilla. All of this feels like a lost cause.
To close out, despite all my bitching and complaining, the legend
make it stop! Ah! No! Ah! You're right, Officer Zilla. You're right. There are things that need to be corrected in that abomination of a video. Awful things. We need to press on.
It's time to finish what I started.
The thing that hamstrings Korra more than anything else that I've already talked about is its themes. The Legend of Korra really wanted to be a smart show for older audiences and get out of the animation age ghetto that, for reasons that continue to elude me, we apparently don't want to be in anymore.
This was addressed in part 3. How did you come to the conclusion that the writers were obsessed with trying to gear the show less toward children? And even if they were, why do you think this is a bad thing? Animation is a vehicle used to tell stories, and those stories can be as lighthearted or as dark as you want them to be. While The Legend of Korra is certainly darker and more complex than its predecessor, it's a long shot away from something that's genuinely dark and not kid-friendly. The writers are allowed to take a slightly darker tone with their story if that's how they felt compelled to write it. Just because something is animated, that doesn't mean it has to be kiddish. There's a time and place for both.
But while their intentions may be good, having to tackle more messy subject matter reveals just how little the writers understand of these issues they're talking about and how little they pay attention to how their own writing affects that. In the very first episode, Korra, and by extension the viewer, is introduced to a protest about benders oppressing non-benders. This fundamental issue forms the basis of the entire season's conflict, with the main villain being the leader of the so-called Equalists who want to strip benders of their power after being oppressed by them for so long. There's just one teeny tiny little niggling, massive, gaping black hole of a problem. Aside from a single dust-up between Korra and the Triads gang, the viewer is never shown any instance of benders actually mistreating non-benders. Even that fight with the Triads shows up after you're introduced to the Equalists, and that gang literally does not show its face again until its leaders show up later to have their bending taken from them by Amon. But if you think they were going the approach of having the Equalists actually be the aggressors, you'd be wrong, because other characters, including Tenzin and other members of the council that controls Republic City, talk about the inequality as if it's been an issue for a very long time. In the first few scenes, Tenzin mentions that Republic City has been getting steadily more unstable and that Amon has been a problem for quite a while. We're told multiple times that Republic City has a classism problem. However, we're never shown it.
The fact you're saying this leads me to believe you weren't paying attention. Again, that, or you're just lying. Or even worse, the details went completely over your head. The United Republic Council, the nation's highest form of government, is made up exclusively of benders. Republic City's police department is made up entirely of benders. So not only is the city's government run by benders, so is their law enforcement. Legally, non-benders are at the sheer mercy of benders in Republic City. Some jobs, like Mako's job working at a power plant, appear to have a preference for benders. Assuming being a bender isn't just an outright requirement for employment. What do we call it when a certain class of people has more job opportunities than another class of people? By extension, being a pro-bender applies to the point above. In fact, it was Mako and Bolin's status as benders that kept them from living in poverty altogether. If you use your head for 5 seconds, it doesn't take long to see how having a class of people with a physical advantage over another class would quickly lead to systematic oppression.
The closest thing to it later on is Tarlok trying to form a special task force to root out the Equalists, essentially becoming a secondary antagonist of the season. But even then, Tarlok's actions are a response to the problem of the Equalists. He's doing his job as far as the viewer's concerned. There's a brief moment where Tarlok starts trying to impose curfews on all non-benders, but it lasts for about one episode before Tarlok is removed from the plot entirely.
Funny how you sweep the curfew enforcement under the rug, because it is yet another example of how much power benders have over non-benders. Look at how easily Tarlok and his officers are able to subjugate the non-benders. These people are guilty of nothing but being non-benders. In the real world, if a very powerful person sought to control the mobility of an entire demographic for the crimes of a few within that demographic, would we not call that oppression? Oh wait, we do! Donald Trump's Muslim ban has absolutely been called oppression of and discrimination against those of Middle Eastern descent. And for good reason. That's precisely what it is. If you were to be consistent, your excuses for Tarlok would have to be applied to Trump. You'd have to say Trump's actions have nothing to do with racism because they were a response to Islamic terrorists. But nothing you can say makes his treatment of Middle Eastern people any less oppressive. The same applies to Tarlok. Tarlok's actions are a symptom of a wider social problem within Republic City, just like how Trump's actions are a symptom of a wider social problem within the United States.
What the writers have done is create an allegory for the civil rights movement, but forgot to create an allegory for the centuries of bigotry and Jim Crow that preceded it.
Because it didn't need to create an allegory for the bigotry and Jim Crow laws that inspired the civil rights movement. The Last Airbender already did that. But don't take my word for it. Why don't you do the explaining for me?
Funnily enough, The Last Airbender actually had this element. Toph is constantly chiding Sokka for not being a bender, and does it so casually that you could be forgiven for thinking that non-benders actually are looked down upon. And it comes up later on when Sokka looks for a teacher in sword fighting to be more capable of assisting in combat. Sokka looks down on himself for being a non-bender, despite being an invaluable asset to the team from day one. The fact that he still can't bend affects him on a fundamental level. This is the kind of material that The Legend of Korra needed so much more of.
Hey, remember how the Legend of Korra is that thing... Oh, what's that word? Sequel? Sequel? Yeah, it's a sequel, meaning it takes pre-established material and expands upon it. This is literally a point against your case that the equalist grievances weren't addressed. We saw the way non-benders were treated in The Last Airbender, so one can reasonably assume this attitude hasn't gone away in the last 70 years.
The introduction to The Legend of Korra describes the United Republic as a place where benders and non-benders from all over the world can live together in peace and harmony. So there's a shitload of context that non-benders might be looked down on by benders, but they never once actually show it to you. This fundamental lack of any explicit context places the equalist in a very strange position as far as antagonist goes. Remember, all the other information surrounding the characters is expecting the viewer to believe that non-bender oppression is a real and serious issue, and that the equalists were pushed into their position. But because none of this important world building is actually presented directly to the viewer, it instead plays out like the straw man version of social justice that internet conservatives like to pretend exists. Amon himself is a waterbender, and his rhetoric about equality is a lie. He wants to purge the world of bending because his daddy was abusive. He even fakes a story about being deformed by a firebender. Why does Amon even have to lie if the problem he pretends to care about supposedly does exist?
Once again, were you even paying attention to the freaking show? I sure hope you just weren't, because the alternative is even worse. The alternative is that you're attempting to spin him on as
just a bad guy with daddy issues,
because it is an inconvenience to the narrative you're trying to push. Here's the reality of the situation. Amon, having grown up with an abusive father, saw the harm benders can do against the weak. He saw how having so much power can corrupt people and lead them to do more harm than good.
The only thing bending has brought to the world is suffering. It has been the cause of every war in every era. But that is about to change.
He and his brother's mistreatment at the hands of their father gave him empathy for the vulnerable. He hid his bender status because it would discount his rhetoric and make him seem hypocritical. How could he have gotten followers if he didn't even seem to believe in his own ideology?
One could say that this was the point, that the writers genuinely held these beliefs and that the entire first season was a criticism of social justice. And yes, I've heard people say that, particularly the people who are dumb enough to think Amon is a communist. But remember that not only does Republic City's government change to better accommodate non-benders in the end, but that Amon himself is deliberately designed to resemble V, a terrorist who actively fought against an unjustifiably fascist government that you actually get to see before you're introduced to him. So the more likely explanation is that the writers were just too lazy to bother with any of that pesky world building that would have put context to the equalists. There's a lot of telling, but absolutely zero showing.
The world building was there. We were shown lots of instances of how benders have societal, physical, economic, and political advantages over non-benders. It just wasn't up in your face. It's a subtle detail, but it's there nonetheless. And that subtlety was actually genius. The audience is seeing Republic City through the perspective of benders. In particular, the most powerful bender of them all. Privileged classes often have a difficult time understanding the plights of the disadvantaged. Just take a look at our world and you'll see what I mean. Even though countless instances of bender privilege play out right before our very eyes, a lot of the audience, like Korra, fails to recognize it as privilege because they are seeing the world through the perspective of that privileged class.
You're given a villain who lies about his own motivations.
Amon didn't lie about his motivations. All he lied about was the fact that he was a bender, and that was only because he was engaging in praxis.
Talks endlessly about a problem you never actually get to see, even though its existence is confirmed by more trustworthy individuals, and at the end you're expected to conclude that he might have had a point and was just going about it the wrong way.
Because Amon did have a point. We saw the ways in which benders have advantages over non-benders. The entire conflict of The Last Airbender was caused by benders.
The specific and consistent issue with The Legend of Korra is that the first three of its villains are supposed to be well-intentioned extremists in some way, but all of them lie.
Amon never lied about his motivations. He only lied about his status as a non-bender, but that was because it would hurt his movement if he did reveal his identity as a bender. Unalaq was a bad two-dimensional villain who can't be considered a well-intentioned extremist. I consider him the only exception when discussing the depth of Korra's villains, but he does lie. Zahir never lied about his goals or motivations. Kuvira never lied about her goals or motivations.
And all the problems they claim to fight against either refuse to show their face.
All the villain's problems were shown. Amon, he had a problem with the inequality in Republic City. We saw various examples of that inequality. Zahir, he had a problem with how unfettered authority can lead to atrocities and limited freedom. The Earth Queen was in Season 3 for a reason. She served as an example of what Zahir was so vehemently opposed to, an example of unchecked, unquestioned authority. The Fire Lords are even a testament to Zahir's point, which was why he used them as an example.
It wasn't too long ago that the Airbenders were nearly all wiped out, thanks to the Fire Lords' desire for world dominance.
Kuvira, she had a problem with all the chaos destabilization wrought on the Earth Kingdom. Please don't tell me I need to show you examples of what called her to action.
Are entirely of their own doing.
None of the villain's problems are of their own doing. Amon, he didn't cause the inequality in Republic City. Zahir, he didn't cause hierarchies to be inherently inclined to gravitate toward authoritarianism. Kuvira, she didn't cause the Earth Kingdom's destabilization.
Or is actually an improvement over what they were trying to create in the world.
Of course, their proposed solutions ended up doing more harm than good. That's what it fundamentally means to be a well-intentioned extremist. If Amon had sensible solutions to the inequality in Republic City, he wouldn't be the villain. If Zahir proposed a form of government that would not allow the powerful to stifle the freedoms of others, he wouldn't be the villain. If Kuvira successfully stabilized the Earth Kingdom without resorting to authoritarianism, she wouldn't be the villain. This is why everyone says Amon, Zahir, and Kuvira had a point, not outright agree with them.
That sounds intentional, but considering that their actions end up also having positive effects on the world puts that assumption into question. After Amon is dealt with, Republic City shows a shift in government to better accommodate non-benders. After Unalaq and that stupid dark avatar are vanquished, humanity ends up having to share the Earth with the spirits anyway, and it's often said that the world is better off for it. Zahir doesn't have a positive effect on the world. His anarchy does what anarchy always does and creates a power vacuum for a tyrant, and it turns out to be the heir to the throne who decides to implement a democratic system, not out of any genuine belief in freedom and voting, but because he doesn't believe he's capable of running a nation.
Really think the Earth Kingdom would be better off if the states were independent and had elected leaders, like the United Republic.
All three of these antagonists seem to stumble into positive solutions to real problems completely by accident. What's the lesson supposed to be here? Wait, that's the lesson the viewer's supposed to take from this? Are you sure about that? Because all these problems were completely unresolved and getting progressively worse until these three stepped in to jumpstart a progressive shift. The Legend of Korra wants to position itself as anti-extremist. That's what the show thinks it is. In practice, however, the Legend of Korra is heavily advocating in favor of extremism because that's the only thing that seems to ever get anything done. It wasn't until someone started making a fuck ton of noise and causing trouble that Republic City was forced to change. It wasn't until someone forced the spirit portals open that humanity became more in touch with the spirits at all. It wasn't until someone killed the Earth Queen that the Earth Queen stopped being a total bitch.
How uncharitable to this show do you have to be to believe this is the message that can be taken away from this? There were clearly repercussions to the extremism of Amon, Zahir, and Kuvira. It's true that, in the real world, extremists are often the ones heard, but with their advocacy almost always comes harm. The Legend of Korra's villains are meant to exemplify how extremism is harmful. Of course the extremism of the villains enacted positive change on the world. It'd be unrealistic of the writers to pretend extremism doesn't get things accomplished. It does. But look at the damage it causes in the process. Instead, The Legend of Korra is urging its viewers to consider a moderate approach before jumping straight to extremism. I can agree with how Amon wanted equal rights and treatment for disadvantaged classes. If I were to go about advocating for these things in my own world, how would I do so? It certainly wouldn't be a good idea to make things equal for everyone by taking things away from innocent people. That would be like what Amon did to the Benders. In a twist of irony, the man who represented the oppressed ended up becoming an oppressor. I have a problem with authoritarianism. I don't like how the government limits freedom and enacts injustices on its own people and beyond. If I were to go about advocating for a way to fix this, I can't just advocate for the complete abolition of the government as a whole. That's what Zahir did. But his actions only ended up backfiring on him because it created grounds for an even more authoritarian regime. Instead, how about I advocate for ways the government can be given less power, or for more ways the government can be balanced to assure it continues to serve its people? Is there even a need for hierarchies in the first place? How can I go about convincing others this is the case? I believe the government should be given the power it needs to maintain order. But how much power is too much? While giving unadulterated power to a single person or a small group can get things done quickly, that power can be easily abused, even by someone with good intentions like Kuvira. If the government is to have a lot of power to maintain order, what systems can be put in place to maintain order within the government itself? If I want to avoid the risk of authoritarianism, are there ways a less powerful government can still keep things in line?
Worst off, this scene with Toph commits the mortal sin of storytelling and tries to retcon the motivations of the three villains to scrub away all their real motivations. The writers back themselves so far into a corner that the only way they could push this extremism bad narrative was to lie and hope nobody's smart enough to remember the previous seasons.
The only villain whose motivations were portrayed poorly in this scene was Unalaq, who was just power hungry. He didn't actually believe in uniting the spirit world and the physical world. That was just a ruse to get Korra to open the portals, which would allow him to reach Vatu. Amon and the Red Lotus's motivations, however, were not retconned.
This weird hodgepodge of contradictory motivations and accidental progress proved to be so confusing that by the final season, the writers pretty much gave up on the idea of covering more mature subject matter, and season 4's villain is just a generic dictator.
I'm going to say it again. Were you watching the show? Kuvira's motivations are just as nuanced as Amon and Zahir's, perhaps even more so, and she wasn't just a generic dictator. I'd like to use this moment to call back to part 2 of this video series. Remember all those forum posts I showed you? Yeah, generic dictator doesn't get you this many in-depth discussions and arguments. Kuvira's call to action was seeing how the Earth Kingdom suffered during its destabilization, and she convinced Batar Jr. and the security force in Zhaofu to join her effort to bring everything back into order. With her at the head of this operation, she was able to make progress quickly, and she successfully reunited almost 90% of the Earth Kingdom in a mere 3 years. But as even you acknowledged later,
Kuvira's bitterness toward the monarchy and fatigue from cleaning up their messes was leading to her rash decisions,
and the power went to her head. The fact that she beat Korra in a one-on-one match in Zhaofu even added to an ego she had garnered over the course of her military accomplishments. Kuvira is an example of how power corrupts even the most noble of intentions, turning a selfless patriot into a conceited, paranoid fascist.
Messing with the spirit vines, acting like a dictator over your people? You had to know what you were doing wasn't right.
I was trying to help my people. Sue turned her back on the Earth Kingdom. You were gone. I had to do something.
But apparently the writers thought that was too subtle, so we have to talk about re-education camps and manufacturing weapons of mass destruction. And just in case you still didn't get that she might be evil, let's work in the Darth Vader force choke just so you really know she's evil. All we're missing is a pathological hatred of foreigners and rhetoric about making the Earth Kingdom great again, and we'll officially have Nazis in Avatar.
I don't know if this was necessarily a criticism of the show or the way Kuvira was portrayed, but I want to respond to it anyway. It bugs me how people, critics and fans of the show alike, keep claiming that the Earth Empire was intended to be the Avatar world's equivalent to Nazi Germany. Anytime a right-wing authoritarian is portrayed in fiction, the general audience's mind jumps straight to Adolf Hitler, but that's more of a reflection of their political naivete. This problem is along the same line as the inaccurate equalists equals communists parallel that keeps getting drawn. It's an aggravatingly lazy assessment of the politics espoused by these groups. There are very few distinct parallels between Kuvira and Hitler that can't also be attributed to fascism. Sure, they were both authoritarian nationalists who opened camps that targeted certain groups, but it's important to keep in mind that the suppression of potential dissenters is a defining characteristic of fascism. That, and their reasons for opening these camps are not the same. And let us not forget that concentration and labor camps are staples of authoritarian governments, both far right and far left. Hitler doesn't have a copyright on concentration camps. So, yeah. Pretty weak case for those who assert that Kuvira was meant to be a Nazi counterpart. She's just a plain old authoritarian. But there is a historical figure that Kuvira does resemble, Chiang Kai-shek, the leader of the Republic of China in the early to mid-1900s. Unlike the spirit energy canon's inspiration, it's never been explicitly stated that Kuvira was inspired by Chiang Kai-shek, but the parallels are so numerous it can't be coincidental.
Kuvira is the only antagonist that doesn't affect any kind of positive change on the world, even indirectly.
You remember how bad Grandma's neighborhood in Ba Sing Se was? All that's completely changed. I mean, we are really helping people.
Now, girl, I know you feel.
We went to this town that had nothing. Most of the people there had never even seen a sodomobile before. But now, they have two sodomobiles, running water, and a magnet train that goes right through their town. I mean, how awesome is that?
She's also the most enjoyable. She's got a simple goal: unite the scattered Earth Kingdom into a strong empire. And while she's willing to use force, she tends to prefer negotiation wherever possible. There are more actual conversations with Kuvira than there are any of the real antagonists you were supposed to take seriously. You remember the problem with Amon and how the supposed oppression against non-benders is talked about a lot but never shown? That happens again with Kuvira, but in reverse, where a lot of the main characters, especially Opal, are constantly talking about all the cliche dictator things she's doing. But because the most you ever see are a few shots of Kuvira looking slightly sinister, crushing a royal medal, and be completely done with this one governor's shit, it all rings hollow.
So, how did a bunch of water and firebenders end up in one of Kuvira's re-education camps?
Call it what it is, a prison.
Kuvira's been purging states of anyone who's not of Earth Kingdom origin, locking them up.
Purging?
What are you acting so surprised for? You must have known what she was up to, being part of her inner circle and all.
Because Kuvira has such a vastly different approach in her design compared to the previous antagonist, I honestly thought that for a while the writers were preparing a bait and switch. Kuvira was initially tasked with reuniting the Earth Kingdom after it had fallen into disarray, but at first they'd asked Su Yin to do the job, and she refused because she's not interested in imposing her ideals on an entire nation, which is the dumbest fucking reason in the world to not quell civil unrest. She says that marching into Ba Sing Se with an army is pretty much asking for trouble, but I'm pretty sure she'd be able to approach reuniting a country that's falling apart in a far more delicate manner than this. The sad part is that Su Yin was last seen ranting about how outdated the concept of a monarchy is, and this is her opportunity to propose something more inclusive for the people. But she doesn't take it for seemingly no reason.
Do you have a problem with President Donald Trump? Do you think his policies are crap? If you were given the opportunity to take over the presidency, would you take it? Not everyone would. There's a difference between criticizing an authority figure and actually wanting to take the position of said authority figure. Su Yin ranted about the Earth Queen, but that didn't mean she was willing to take her place. What I like about this scene is the fact that there's no clearly correct answer here. In fact, it's quite balanced.
Hey, it's like balance is the theme in this season, uh-huh?
Both Kuvira and Su Yin bring equally valid points to the table. Both have their pros, both have their cons.
Su Yin's explanation is so absolute, so black and white, so devoid of any nuance, that I could not possibly imagine that it had been written with sincerity. I could only assume that it was written just so it could be thrown back in her face.
Is there something wrong with the character making a poor decision and suffering the consequences?
She does this again after Kuvira announces that she's overthrowing the monarchy. Now faced with actual reasoning that Kuvira might be letting the power go to her head, Su Yin has the opportunity to tell Kuvira that this is exactly what she was afraid of, and that Kuvira's bitterness toward the monarchy and fatigue from cleaning up their messes was leading to her rash decisions, but can't actually come up with anything to say to her beyond the platitude of "what makes you think you're so different?" A worthless non-criticism that infests YouTube comments is the best line we can think of to come out of a supposed world leader.
This scene could have been worded better to bolster Su Yin's case. Not only would doing so make Su Yin sound more convincing, it would also allow for Kuvira to showcase her conviction when she inevitably disagrees. But let's stop, take a step back, and observe the bigger picture here.
Almost all of your criticisms up until this point have been determined to be lies, speculation, or misconceptions, and we've only agreed on a few things. Among the very few things we agree on is this one particular scene, which could have been worded better. This is how weak your case is against this show. It is so weak that one of your only valid criticisms so far is on how one scene is worded. And even if this scene's dialogue were improved, the outcome wouldn't change.
In the first episode, when Kuvira is trying to negotiate unity with a governor, he starts yammering on about how great his state is when it's being beset by bandits at every possible opportunity, and they're all barely holding together, and the situation becomes so dire that his refusal is probably going to doom his people. Kuvira responds by giving him the most appropriate look imaginable. After hearing all of it, all the ridiculous nonsense, the meaningless platitudes, all the moaning and whining and crying and belly aching from the main characters throughout the entire season, I was thoroughly expecting the writers to pull the rug out from underneath everyone and have Kuvira actually build a functioning nation,
That would have been pretty cool.
And just ask, why? Why is the Avatar so fucking incompetent that she's getting her ass kicked at every turn, to the point that a complete lunatic was able to destabilize the Earth Kingdom?
It wasn't Korra's fault that Zaheer killed the Earth Queen. She was busy escaping the Earth Queen's custody in the middle of the desert while he was suffocating her to death.
Hey, Korra! Why didn't you just teleport to Ba Sing Se and stop Zaheer?
Another ship is on the way. We just need to hold our position for a few hours.
We might not have a few hours.
Maybe I forgot to mention something to you. I don't believe in queens.
A lunatic that, by his own admission, didn't expect such anarchy to create a power vacuum, despite the fact that it's common knowledge that anarchy always creates a power vacuum.
Why? Why was the villain wrong? Don't the writers know the villains are supposed to be right?
Why did the most trusted world leader and most respected figure in the world think it wasn't possible to reunite a broken country without being seen as Hitler?
Su Yin, I'm not interested in using military force to impose my ideals on the largest nation in the world, as it may agitate the problem. Translation: I don't think I can do this without being seen as Hitler.
Why did everyone who wanted the Earth Kingdom to be reunited suddenly start bitching and moaning when it was actually being done?
Kuvir has been purging states of anyone who's not of Earth Kingdom origin and locking them up.
Maybe that's why?
While the Avatar was on the lam fighting boxing matches and playing in the mud with Toph.
Ozai was out destroying people's lives while the Avatar was busy looking for his pet. Fire Lord Ozai and his army were busy slaughtering people left and right while the Avatar was busy sitting around on rocks with an old man.
See how I can make just about anything look bad by phrasing it in a certain disingenuous way?
But if you were like me and were thinking that maybe the writers were about after echoing the Earth Queen's sentiments about the United Republic being Earth Kingdom territory, and the reason you didn't see her doing any of the horrible shit people claim she was doing was for the same reason you didn't see non-benders being oppressed. Fucking laziness, because it sounds like a dictator, and that's all we need apparently. It's exactly the kind of ending you'd fucking expect from the rest of The Legend of Korra, and yet that somehow still feels disappointing. And suddenly, we realize why Su Yin had a sudden attack of stupidity earlier. Because the writers created a story idea so stupid within their own fiction that all of a sudden, the hyper-progressive woman who would normally jump at the opportunity to espouse the virtues of democracy has to develop a sense of doomed paranoia.
You're pulling stuff out of your butt at this point. Nowhere did Su Yin endorse democracy. Nowhere did she express sentiments of wanting to roll up her sleeves and enact political change on the world's largest nation.
All this comes down to one massive problem. The writers are trying to cover heavy and complicated subject matter that they're not equipped to cover for an audience that isn't equipped to absorb them. It's actually pretty common for fans of Legend of Korra to compare Amon's equalist movement with communism or Marxism, something that would completely baffle you if you have any knowledge whatsoever about communism or Marxism. But because Amon says equality a lot, that triggers the communism senses in the permanently uneducated and the criminally witless.
So you do know Amon and the Equalists weren't intended to be communists. Then why did you pretend they were intended to be communists in section 3 of your video? You know, back when you ascribed them as one of the ways the world was becoming Americanized?
Western neoliberal capitalist propaganda. The first season's bad guys are essentially the bastardized, poorly understood version of communism that Americans have been so thoroughly terrified of for decades, dressed up with a fresh coat of Occupy Wall Street paint.
It's almost like you've been dishonestly twisting everything with the intent to make this show look bad.
Or worse still, how the show is very strongly pushing the idea that democracy is the best option, but never once decides to showcase the actual virtues of democracy itself. It's just, it's good because we say so, and all the other options suck because they're not democracy, which is an ironically fundamentalist view of the concept.
Democracy is only portrayed as a superior alternative in two instances, Republic City and the Earth Kingdom. Republic City's old system determined leaders by what is essentially their race. The Earth Kingdom's old system determined leaders by birthright, and literally every Earth Kingdom monarch we know of so far has been infamous for incompetence. I don't have to explain to you why democracy is preferable to those kinds of systems, nor did the show have to explain that to you. This is also relevant. as of September 2019. It would appear that Ruins of the Empire is headed toward the direction of depicting the downsides of democracy.
It's often said that The Legend of Korra is aimed for older teenagers, and I believe it because it showcases a teenager's understanding of the socio-political issues it tries in vain to cover. The way it talks about freedom and equality and order and chaos is the kind of nonsensical rhetoric I'd expect to hear out of myself at 14. It's a worthless spit in the face to anyone who expects their intelligence to be respected.
You're mad at this show for supposedly not respecting your intelligence. Yet you were just getting angry at it for not explaining why democracy is better than monarchy and racially determined hierarchy. I can't take you seriously anymore.
And for a series that loves to position itself as the mature alternative to The Last Airbender, the way it presents all of its themes is extremely childish. Extremism is bad, except it's the only thing that actually works.
The show is asking its viewers to consider moderate alternatives to extremism.
Your life will be affected by change, except not really.
Korra is constantly affected by change.
The key to overcoming trauma is to put yourself in a vulnerable position with the person who fucked you up.
That wasn't the point of this scene.
Domestic abuse is funny.
Addressed.
The scars of genocide can be healed by praying really hard.
Ignoring the fact that the return of the Airbenders brought about regicide, destabilization, the near death of the Avatar entity as a whole. The rise of a fascist, the creation of what are essentially this world's equivalent of nuclear weapons.
Democracy is great, and everything else is an evil virus of Satan. No, we won't explain why. Fuck you.
That made my head hurt.
The big reason The Last Airbender stuck so well with people is because it's a story about characters. It's not a story about themes.
Correction. The Last Airbender, like The Legend of Korra, was a show about characters and themes. Every story has its characters and themes, but one of the signs of good writing is effectively balancing the two. Contrary to the way this video spins it, it's a good thing to explore themes within your story, because they serve as lessons the audience can use to apply to their lives. Themes are what make a story bigger than itself. And it's the job of the characters to deliver that message. The Last Airbender, because it is a well-written show, explores its themes through its characters. War, good versus evil, friendship, remaining loyal to one's principles. The Legend of Korra does the same. Extremism, balance, mental illness, and most importantly, identity. This is one of the respects in which I believe The Legend of Korra outdoes its predecessor. While the themes explored in The Last Airbender are fine and dandy, The Legend of Korra rolls up its sleeves and tackles subjects that are much more complicated and less black and white. These things are some of the unavoidable aspects of adulthood, particularly as one becomes increasingly aware of politics and, by extension, the very society they live in.
A generic evil empire centered around the most destructive of the four elements. The Fire Nation has a constant presence throughout the world, showing you specifically why they're a threat. The heroes are a ragtag team of kids fighting a giant, all-consuming evil. It's the first Star Wars, but with monks. It's a very simple, straightforward story. The closest thing to a complicated moral question that ever comes up is whether or not Aang is going to kill the Fire Lord. A question that ends up not having to be answered because the writers backed out of it at the last second. The appeal came from things like Sokka's sarcasm, Toph's attitude, Iroh talking about the nature of the elements and the nature of individual character-specific decisions, not abstract, nebulous concepts like freedom. It's a simple story with a simple conflict. It had to be because it was aimed at children. So most of the internal struggles came from things that resonated with children, like absent parents, abusive families, the pressure of sudden responsibility, all things that resonate with a lot of kids. All dressed up in Star Wars meets Mulan cosplay. But at its core, being very simple to digest and with valuable lessons. The villains of The Last Airbender are not complex. They didn't need to be. The complexity came from the main characters. It didn't matter if Ozai, Azula, or Ty Lee weren't particularly complex. The characters that needed to be compelling were Aang, Katara, Toph, Zuko, and Sokka. The Fire Lord didn't need this half-assed philosophy. He needed to be powerful and dangerous because his purpose was to be the culmination of Aang's character arc, and he served that purpose excellently. The Last Airbender is not a very mature show. It's silly. It has simple themes and extremely simple antagonists. It's a show where you could totally call a villain Sparky Sparky Boom Man, not Bat-Nine.
There are a lot of really insecure people who get very angry at the idea that animated shows are only for children. But the reality is that animated shows and movies are often at their best when they're made with kids in mind. There simply isn't a theme worth exploring that actively requires the trappings of a mature movie. Harry Potter is beloved by children, but that's a book series that's literally about the rise and fall of an autocrat, with a villain who is defined by the idea idea that anything less than complete purity of blood will lead to the destruction of wizard kind. Pixar movies are pretty fucking deep and actually pretty smart when you stop and think about them. You're not gonna get more value out of an R-rated animated movie. A movie doesn't get an R rating for smart themes and the exploration of the horrors of humanity. It's gonna get an R rating because there's boobs and penises and lots of swearing and blood. That's not a disparaging observation, that's just the reality of how the MPAA decides its ratings. The reason adult animation so often fails is because it's never made by people who wanted to make a good story. They're made by people who are really insecure about animation being for children, and when you start from that foundation, nothing you make will ever be good.
We're gonna stop talking about The Legend of Korra for a minute, because what Lily is saying here is so shallow that I can't leave it unaddressed.
There exist certain portrayals of themes that are simply not appropriate for children. When some themes, like war, are delivered to a younger audience, things obviously have to be whitewashed, and that's okay. Kids need to be aware that the world isn't all sunshine and rainbows. There is war, there is murder, there is sexual assault. It's healthy and valuable to explore these themes in children's media, responsibly of course. But there's also value in depicting these things with the R-rated grittiness of reality. It's a bucket of cold water, a reminder of how real and how horrific these things actually are. It's something not all of us realize or experience from our cushy first world homes. And if the artist feels the honest conviction that they want to deliver that depiction in the form of animation, that's perfectly fine. The Legend of Korra takes a step closer to this side of the spectrum, but there's no evidence to suggest that the creators wanted to do so just because they were trying to prove animation isn't just for kids. That simple fact renders this entire monologue useless.
Avatar was a very smart show because it wasn't focused on being anything more than what it was. It just had to work with the tools it had. We get a really funny episode with Zilla trying and failing to adapt to civilian life, and that implicitly tells us just how much damage her father's done to her. Or Zuko journeying alone through the Earth Kingdom and seeing the effects that his father's war has had on people, and how quickly they turned on him upon discovering who he was. Because we weren't getting wrapped up in poorly thought out philosophy, we got to see something truly amazing: the effects that war has on people. This seemingly shallow setup that many fans nowadays try to pretend is less interesting than Legend of Korra opens up a lot of opportunities as the characters journey across the world, meet new people struggling with war, and get into a lot of smaller adventures along the way. The writers had no way of knowing which moments would resonate the most with people, and that could potentially be why they resonated with so many. The fact is, when it came time to make a sequel, the writers were more concerned about recapturing that magic rather than just telling an interesting story.
There's a big problem with this statement. Did you catch it? If you didn't, let's listen to it again and see if you can.
The fact is, when it came time to make a sequel, the writers were more concerned about recapturing that magic rather than just telling an interesting story.
Did you catch it this time?
The fact is...
The fact is...
The fact is...
The fact is... So you say. So that would imply you know it's a fact that Brian and Mike were
more concerned about recapturing that magic rather than just telling an interesting story.
Yet you've provided no means to verify if this is true. No. I'm actually going to use this little phrase accurately here. The fact is, this statement is yet another one of your unfounded pieces of biased speculation. Let's go through the rotting wood you used to support this point.
Which is why the new cast of characters is just the old cast of characters, but grown up and more generically pretty.
We're going to talk about it in a second.
Why all the reskins of Ozai try to build on Fire Lord Sozin's Manifest Destiny bullshit because the writers mistakenly thought that was the part about the Fire Nation that was interesting.
Literally none of the villains have much in common with Sozin or Ozai. Unalaq is probably the closest because he's also a two-dimensional evil-for-evil-sake villain. But if we went off that similarity, you can say countless other fictional villains in animation are Sozin or Ozai reskins.
The fact is, Amon, Zahir, Kuvira, and hell, even Unalaq, as lame as he was, have belief systems that are completely independent of the Fire Lords. To state otherwise is just plain disingenuous. And I can't believe you would make a statement like this after spending the last few sections discussing the unique politics of each villain in depth. This is a bald-faced lie. You know what you just said wasn't true. You know none of the villains were modeled after the Fire Lords. So I must ask here, why did you say this?
I'm sure a lot of people would blame Nickelodeon for executive meddling, how the creators didn't have time to build on all their interesting ideas, and that's why they fell flat. But the sad thing is that the creators did have the time, they just didn't bother. Remember that Civil War storyline? They had an entire second half of the season to build on that, but the creators clearly felt it was more important to explain the origins of the Avatar and introduce the God and Satan analogies.
We've been over this. Since the end of episode 2 of season 2, the conflict between the Southern Water Tribe and Unalaq was black and white. This was the writer's intent from season 2's inception.
They made the choice to fill the third season with explosions and bending fights over any real story.
You'd have to have not been paying attention to season 3 to think there was no story. But the fact is, I know you were paying attention. I know you were deliberately lying. You know there was a story in season 3 because you dedicated the first 9.5 minutes of section 6 to explaining the plot to your audience. That's 78% of the entire section all dedicated to you simply going through the plot of that particular season.
They made the choice to spend more time on pro-bending than on establishing the actual conflict of the first season.
Lily. The Last Airbender was good because it invested most of its time in exploring and developing characters instead of its simple conflict. Also Lily, the pro-bending segments, which served as a means to explore and develop Mako, Korra, and Bolin and their dynamics, are bad because the writers should have spent more time exploring the conflict.
They made the choice to clone the previous gang without any thought to truly developing any of them. You see the opportunities they had to make something truly great in the moments with Tenzin and his family, or Lin Bei Fong, and wonder why they weren't the supporting characters instead of not Zuko, not Sokka, and not Suki.
It's time for more Venn Diagrams!
Alrighty, let's look at Bald Boy here. He's male, spiritual, peaceful, orphaned, you know, the basic stuff. Let's compare that to Korra, who was literally designed to be the exact opposite!
Not Zuko.
Mako and Zuko. Okay, let's see here. Not much these guys have in common besides that. They're both firebenders with a serious disposition. Let's move on to the next one and see if we have any luck there.
Not Sokka.
Yikes. Even less similarities between Bolin and Sokka. The only thing these two really have in common is their usage of comic relief. But even then, their styles of humor differ from one another. Sokka's humor is dry, whereas Bolin's humor stems from his airheadedness. Maybe the next one will look different?
And not Suki.
I can't even see where you drew this parallel besides the fact that Suki and Asami are both non-benders that can hold their own in a fight. They come from completely different backgrounds, have completely different things happen to them throughout the course of the series, and have completely different roles within their respective stories. You know, it says a lot about your ability to analyze these characters if you've boiled them down to these singular traits.
No, the problems with Korra are not Nickelodeon's fault. It's entirely on Brian and Mike themselves. If they didn't have enough time, it's because they wasted all their time on all this bullshit.
You can say you don't think they had enough time, but it's simply not the truth. The writing for this show was on an extremely tight schedule. Back in 2011, The Legend of Korra was pitched as a 12-episode miniseries. The season 1's sublime quality made Nickelodeon order more during production. According to this post on Konietzko's blog, season 2 was ordered before season 1's premiere, and shortly afterward, Nickelodeon then ordered seasons 3 and 4. At the latest, these commissions occurred in July of 2012. A month after the first season finished airing on TV. That leaves around this much time at most for 3 more seasons to be produced. You may think this is plenty of time to write the script for 40 more episodes, but here's the thing, it isn't. This is an absurdly short amount of time to produce 40 episodes of an animated series, especially a series that has earned the reputation of having sleek, crisp animation. Bryke and the writing team had to get everything written ASAP, and that's because writing is the easy part of producing an animated series. Sound design, the extremely complicated process of animation, especially animation of this quality, voice directing, and marketing need as much time as they can get. But these steps in the process can't do anything until they have the script. If one of the writers came up with a great idea for season 2 while they were writing season 3, too bad. Season 2 was already written and sent to South Korea to be animated. Voice actors were already memorizing and recording their lines. The sound designer was already composing tracks and sound effects that suit certain scenes. They had reached a point of no return. No time for polish. Every script was a commitment.
I'm not necessarily saying any of this should be used to excuse the flaws with this show, but I think it's important to consider the circumstances under which a piece of media was created when assessing its quality. And let it be made clear, this show is a marvel. It's a marvel because despite its utterly cursed production circumstances, it still pulled through. It was still an incredible, groundbreaking show that earned critical reception, Annie Awards, Emmy Awards, and several other awards from other organizations, and is regarded as one of the best animated series ever produced. I can only imagine how much greater the show would have been if all of its seasons were commissioned at once, like The Last Airbender.
And the only way I could see them being organized any worse is if they made a show exclusive to Netflix. To close out, despite all my bitching and complaining over the course of this video, The Legend of Korra does have one notable achievement. It is the worst thing that Seychell Gabriel has ever been involved in, and that's gotta be worth some kind of medal. You could say what you like, but this is what really motivated me to go through the torment I've subjected you all to over the last hour. It's a small scene from the first season, and it's only about 10 seconds long. When I think about this scene, I think about the very obvious fact that somebody wrote in the script, Korra's face juts out like Pee-wee's Big Adventure, while the background explodes and lightning strikes and flashes repeatedly before zooming back to reality. And this somehow went from the first draft, through multiple revisions, the table read, the final draft, the storyboards, the animation, and then to the final editing room with absolutely nobody asking why. You remember how I said The Legend of Korra is working its hardest to repeat well-known bits from The Last Airbender? Well, The Last Airbender was well known for its silly and goofy faces because that's the kind of show it is. Because the writers are so desperate to recapture every scrap of magic they can, they went as far as they could to create as many meme faces as possible, and this is one of those attempts taken to its impossible extreme. Out of curiosity, I went and searched Korra face on Google Images, and not only was this not the first result, but the first result was an extremely better and less desperate version of Korra making a surprised oh shit face not 20 seconds later, because the writers are more successful when they stop trying to lick the scraps the previous series has left behind. Some people will say that Korra wasn't well received because it wasn't The Last Airbender, but I firmly believe that Korra wasn't as well received because it tries too hard to be The Last Airbender.
Here's that scene again. This is Nichiju.
Ah!
Now, which is more likely? The Legend of Korra, which you lambasted for being too different from The Last Airbender in the first few sections of your video, was trying too hard to be like The Last Airbender. Or The Legend of Korra and The Last Airbender, because they are both anime that follow the majority of anime tropes, is written like an anime, and is animated like an anime, derives a sense of humor from over-exaggerated facial expressions. Just like anime! I'll let you be the judge.
Most of the side characters are children or grandchildren of the old characters.
Remember, kids, if a sequel series has any characters that are somehow related to the last series, that's smoking gun evidence that the creators were lazily trying to rip themselves off. If we were to apply Lily's logic everywhere else, no sequel series would ever be allowed to use characters or elements from its parent series. It would have to be something so fundamentally different from its parent series that it might as well be an independent intellectual property at that point.
The new gang is the hot topic-y versions of the old gang.
No.
The new villains are the old villains with 10 times more overt political themes.
Oh yeah, we determined this was a lie. It's like Lily forgot about everything that was in the middle of her script while she was writing the last part of it. Or maybe she thinks so little of her audience that she's relying on them to forget what had been addressed barely 20 minutes ago.
All the old stuff, but even more. Or, if I could snip some more lines from H-Bomber Guy, slight variations on this frame. The one thing Legend of Korra didn't copy from The Last Airbender is the one thing that made The Last Airbender special. It was different. It did things that no other show has ever done. The Legend of Korra is cliche after cliche after cliche. Good night.
Listening to Lily Orchard criticize The Legend of Korra is rather like trying to play chess with a pigeon. It knocks the pieces over, craps on the board, and flies back to its flock to claim victory. S.D. Weizenhofer, I think.
I think we did it, shipmates.
We made it through the whole video.
But this isn't the end. There's still one last important thing left to do.
This was an extremely long response series, mostly because your Admiral is a wordy little ditch barker. Thanks to the sheer length of this series and the amateurishness of my earlier videos, things have gotten somewhat convoluted. Thus, I think it would be beneficial to do a speed run through all of Lily's points, section by section, and give a brief summary of all of my counter-arguments. This recap certainly won't be as detailed as my actual response, but this will be a good opportunity to tidy things up, add additional points to my arguments, and most importantly, acknowledge and reconcile some mistakes I've made in previous parts.
For the sake of keeping this recap organized, I'm going to go through each book and extract all the main criticisms that were made, then sort them in accordance with this table. The first column will be for points that were countered with an explanation as to why the criticism isn't valid. Should one continue to insist the original criticism is valid, the criticism would then have to be considered a subjective opinion. Which brings us to the next column, which, as its name would imply, is designated for criticisms that are purely subjective in nature. While all criticism, including professional, is ultimately subjective, these particular opinions are so casual that it's difficult to provide any evidence that supports or counters the criticism. Think of it as two people disagreeing on what the best color is. Saying, "The color green is bad because I don't like it," would not be a valid criticism of the color green in an analytical environment. It's fine if you personally don't like the color green, but please don't shove your personal distaste for it into what is supposed to be a critical analysis. The third column will be for speculation, which is when Lily makes a positive assertion against the show that has yet to be proven true or false. This particular type of criticism is extremely unprofessional, because it judges a piece of media based on its conjectured merit, not its actual tangible merit. The next column will be for criticisms that contradict previous criticisms and forces the Legend of Korra into a damned if you do and damned if you don't position. The next column will contain inconsistent standards. An inconsistent standard would be an instance in which Lily criticizes the Legend of Korra for containing a certain element, but does not apply that criticism to other pieces of media that contain the same element. The second to last column will be for factual inaccuracies and lies. A factual inaccuracy would be an assertion that directly contradicts the source material. The last column is reserved for criticisms that do not fall into any of the previous categories and are thus valid criticisms that can be appropriately levied against the show. When going through this recap of her points, I'm not going to repeat points if they've already been made in a previous book. I had to put that out there because Lily's video was remarkably sloppy. The same points are repeated all over the place. With that said and out of the way, let's start. Book 1. Point 1. The Legend of Korra is bad because it uses a serialized story structure, unlike The Last Airbender, which used an episodic story structure. I explained how, between episodic and serialized story structures, there is no superior storytelling method, as both have their pros and cons. You can have the opinion that episodic story structures are superior, but that remains just that, your opinion. Thus, it isn't a valid criticism of the show. Point 2. The new characters, Mako, Bolin, and Asami, don't have anything to work with. The only characters that get characterization are Tenzin and Lin. This is not true. Throughout the course of the series, Mako, Bolin, and Asami have individual struggles that alter their characters by the end of the fourth season. Mako grows from a selfish fuckboy to a responsible adult. Bolin grows from a dependent teenager to a self-sustaining adult. Asami grows from a pampered rich girl to a successful, independent industrialist that not only saved her company from going under, but also integrated the spirits in mankind. Those, of course, are just brief summaries of how they changed throughout the course of the series. Here's a side note. This particular criticism suggests to me that Lily's ability to analyze growth and characterization is short-sighted. Tenzin and Lin, the only characters she praises for having characterization, are uncoincidentally the two characters whose development is focused on and resolved within the span of a few episodes, whereas Korra, Asami, Mako, and Bolin's character development spans throughout the entire series. Point 3. Amon wanted to purge non-benders because he had daddy issues. This is not true. Amon honestly believed that bending ultimately caused more harm than good in the world, like war and inequality. It was his abusive upbringing that instilled this mindset in him. Point 4. Zahir is stupid because anarchism is a bad political ideology. I explain how anarchism is a much more complicated and nuanced political ideology than Lily makes it out to be. As such, it was fertile ground for exploration, as it brings up questions in regard to anti-authoritarianism that the viewer can think on. Point 5. The seasons were too short to give the villains the time they needed to explore the complex political ideologies. I explain how each season does an adequate job introducing, explaining, and resolving the villain's ideology. Does that mean it couldn't have been done better? Of course not. Having more time to unpack the details of each villain would have been great, but what was already done was sufficient. This is ultimately a clash in opinions between the two of us. Point 6. The episode Reminiscences did not benefit the show. We've finally reached the first valid criticism Lily has for this show. While I did explain the production circumstances that led to this episode and how it wasn't the creator's fault, it is still a part of the show, which is what's being critiqued here. The episode itself was well made when considering its circumstances, and it was great as far as recaps go. However, it would have only been a positive for the show if it were an online or DVD bonus, and the 8th episode of season 4 was a proper episode that added more progress to the story. Point 7. Side plots are thrown sporadically between the main plot instead of focusing on each separately. I explained how I noticed that this is DiMartino's writing style. While the constant shift in scenes can be jarring to some, I personally was not bothered by it. Ultimately, this comes down once again to a clash in opinions, as someone who likes this style of storytelling is not objectively correct, and vice versa. Book 2. Point 1. It was inefficient of the writers to make Korra learn bending at a young age, as the writers already had a reason for her to be proficient with the three elements before the series started. Originally, I agreed with Lily on this point, but I now disagree with it after gaining a new understanding of this scene's purpose. Throughout the series, Korra's biggest struggle is coming to terms with the fact that her value as a person and her value as the Avatar are not supposed to be intertwined. This scene is a narrative tool that demonstrates how Korra has synonymized herself with being the Avatar since she was a child, which sets her up for the struggle she's going to be dealing with for the rest of the first season and beyond. Point 2. Korra's sudden ability to airbend was pulled out of nowhere. I did a poor job of explaining how Korra's ability to airbend did not come out of nowhere, so I'll cite someone who did a good job at explaining it.
The first season establishes that Korra is impatient, and that's a major character flaw that she carries throughout the series and is why she can't learn airbending. Air is the element of freedom, after all, and that was something Korra never had growing up with the White Lotus, and after coming to Republic City, she was hated and ridiculed by almost everyone there because she was impatient and didn't bother to acclimate to life in the city. By leaving the South Pole, she gained physical freedom, she could go wherever she wanted, but she lost mental freedom because she has to be conscious of every action she takes in the city, so she can't be her natural, reactionary self. Aman challenges all of that. While Korra is brash and reactionary, Aman is calm and calculated. Korra is defined by her ability to bend the elements. She thinks that that's all the Avatar is, and Aman takes pride in taking people's bending away, and to do so to the Avatar would be his greatest achievement. When he takes Korra's bending away, he also takes away her entire identity. This is why she doesn't just go in and face Aman directly earlier in the season, because she's afraid he'll take her identity from her. While impatience is one of her defining traits, another is trepidation. As impatient as she is to solve the problem at hand, Korra is also very reluctant to go in and actually do it. These two things combined are what creates Korra's mental block that further prevents her from airbending. They are two contradictory mindsets in that being impatient and then not acting on that impatience results in nothing getting solved and things getting worse. Once Mako was about to lose his bending right in front of her and she couldn't do anything to stop it was when she finally snapped and did something. All of her fear about losing her bending slash identity was gone because she didn't have that anymore, so she had nothing else to lose by acting, something that she stopped herself from doing because she was afraid to lose her bending. Korra learning airbending wasn't a deus ex machina Mary Sue moment, it wasn't pulled out of nowhere, it was thematic, and meant to show her change in character. She struggled to airbend for the whole season because she was being held back by her mentality at the time that bending is what makes an Avatar, and being forced to not act made it even harder. So once her mentality was challenged to the highest degree, she was forced to act in order to save her friend, which was the only other notable thing she valued.
Point 3. Korra is given everything on a silver platter. I explained how Korra getting the Avatar state so early doesn't necessarily mean she is handed everything without working for it. Her aptitude for the physical side of being the Avatar is balanced by the spiritual and emotional lessons she must learn throughout the course of the series, such as behaving more diplomatically and her overall spirituality. Point 4. Korra is immature because the first thing she used the Avatar state for was to win a race against children. I explained how this scene was used as a narrative tool to highlight one of Korra's character flaws that is getting set up to be fixed throughout the season and beyond. Point 5. Korra doesn't suffer the consequences of the actions of those and herself. This is not true. Some of the biggest turning points in the show and Korra's character arc is the result of her actions and others' actions. It was because of Unalaq that she can no longer receive guidance and wisdom from her past lives. It was because of her decision to leave the spirit portals open that the world was fundamentally changed, and she was unpopular among the people because of it. It was because of the actions of the Red Lotus that she was brutally broken, both physically and mentally. Point 6. Korra gets help from others during fights. I explain how this actually supports my case that Korra isn't handed everything on a silver platter. Point 7. Having Korra be deprived of a natural Avatar journey sets her up for failure, and it wasn't interesting. This is ultimately an opinion that I and many others happen to disagree with. Korra's unorthodox Avatar journey made the story less predictable and gave her an interesting character struggle. Point 8. The Legend of Korra relies too heavily on chest beam lasers and air suffocation. This is not true, as the former only happens once, and the latter only happens twice. Point 9. Korra doesn't mature as a character. This is not true, and it's a patently absurd statement to make, as Korra's character development throughout the span of the four seasons is so great that the Book 1 Korra is almost a completely different character compared to the Book 4 Korra. I'm willing to go out on a limb and say that her character arc is one of the best I've ever seen in animation. Point 10. Korra's response to the Season 3 finale was not justified, as her fight with Unalaq was more traumatic and she shrugged it off just fine. This is not true. As I explained in Part 3, the way Korra was affected by being tortured by the Red Lotus was believable and justified. Originally, I said Korra's recovery arc could have been done better, but I retract that statement. This arc was handled very well, save for the resolution of her PTSD. Point 11. The show doesn't dwell on how Bolin's decision to help Kuvira was the opposite direction of Zahir's anarchism, His inability to pick up on Kuvira's badness was passed as him just being stupid. Originally, I agreed that Bolin was not given any characterization, but I retract this statement as well. Bolin's biggest struggle throughout the series is establishing himself as an independent adult that no longer needs to rely on his older brother, and his temporary allyship with Kuvira was a component of this arc. Book 3. Point 1. Unlike The Last Airbender, bending, as seen in The Legend of Korra, does not take any inspiration from real-life martial arts. This is not true. As I explained in Part 2, each bending style remains distinct and still pulls from real-life Asian martial arts in form, style, and disposition. Point 2. The Legend of Korra does not show the characteristics of certain bending forms being incorporated into other bending forms. This emphasizes the interchangeable nature of bending and The Legend of Korra. This is not true. Lava bending is the incorporation of water bending and earth bending. Kuvira's agile style of earthbending draws heavily from the light-footed style of airbending. Point 3. The Legend of Korra showcases no creativity or resourcefulness with its bending. This is not true, as multiple characters, such as Su Yin, Mako, Kuvira, and Ming Kwa, creatively use their bending to their advantage. Point 4. The animation is bad. This is an opinion, and a ridiculous one at that. Point 5. The avatar state was nerfed. I explained how this is explained in the narrative, and serves as a purpose in Korra's character arc. Point 6. The pro bending is bad because it ruins bending. I explained how sports is a logical application of bending in a modern setting. Additionally, it parallels how martial arts has become a sport in the real world. Point 7. Pro bending took up too much time in Season 1. I agreed with this somewhat because the pro bending segments, while well written and enjoyable to watch, should have been focused on less. There were more useful applications of that time. Point 8. Focusing on the industrialized, less bending-focused Republic City ruins the world-building. I explained how this plays a role in Korra's character arc, specifically the aspect that she must detach her individual identity from being the Avatar. Thanks to evolving technology, the world is becoming less dependent on the Avatar, and she is doomed to lose her self-worth unless she determines who she is. Point 9. The 1920s steampunk setting was bad because it is oversaturated in media. This is an opinion, and a strange one at that. There's nothing wrong with using the steampunk motif, especially if it is handled correctly and uniquely, like it is in The Legend of Korra. This was also something I found funny.
And the hilarious part is that Republic City is the only place this fucking happens. You see many glimpses of the Water Tribes in the Earth Kingdom, and they're still very much steeped in their cultural architecture and design.
A few moments later.
It's actually alarming just how much of the cultural origins of the world of Avatar gets scrubbed by the creeping Americanization of the entire world.
Is it the whole world getting Americanized, or is it just Republic City? Pick one. You can only have one.
Point 10. The world became too Americanized because of Republic City, the God vs. Satan analogies with Rava and Vatu, capitalism, pro-democracy undertones, the United Republic's origins, Western architecture, and Western technology. This is not true. Rava and Vatu do not make for a good God vs. Satan analogy. The show is only pro-democracy in two instances. The United Republic's origins look nothing like the origins of the United States. Republic City looks distinctly Asian in its architecture. The Western technology used throughout the show is no more prominent than the Western technology used in The Last Airbender. Point 11. Bringing back the Airbenders destroyed the Scars of War theme of the last series, and it is convenient. While I can see where Lily is coming from, I explained how the show handles this aspect very well. The return of the Airbenders provided new events that continue to build characters, was a call to action in Season 3, and introduced new problems in the world. Such as how Zaheer learning airbending caused a domino effect that led to the rise of Kuvira. Point 12. The Air Nomad's culture has been scrubbed away to be airbending and nothing else. This is not true. The Air Nomads continue to practice staples of their culture. Point 13. Amon and the Equalist is another example of the Americanization of the world because they are supposed to be communists, which Americans have been conditioned to be terrified of. This is not true. It is thanks to the political naivete of some viewers that led to the perpetuation of the Equalists equals communist conflation. Book 4, Point 1. The love triangle was handled tactlessly. While I can see where Lily is coming from, I explain how it can be argued that the love triangle was messy on purpose, as the characters involved are acting as people of their age would act. This is supported by the fact that the dynamic between Tenzin, Pema, and Lin, who are in a similar situation, is handled with far more grace. Point 2. Mako's actions in Season 2 caused an unwanted return of the love drama. I explain how this response from Mako is to be expected from his characterization, seeing that he is immature in the first two seasons. I have my own criticisms in regard to this scene that I will discuss in another video. Point 3. The show has a sexist double standard when it comes to subordinating relationships. This is not true. The dynamic between Varric and Zhu Li is similar to that of Eska and Bolin. Point 4. The show treats an abusive relationship like it's funny. I explained how the humor wasn't derived from the supposed abuse that's taking place, but from the ridiculousness of the situation, as well as how it parodies the yandere trope. Point 5. The show would have benefited from taking Eska and Desna seriously. This is an excellent criticism of the second season. Point 6. The show has a demeaning view of women, as Korra is constantly put in situations that rob her of her agency and is saved by male characters. This is not true, as Korra is never put in a damsel in distress situation. When she is in situations where she is unable to help herself, male characters are not the only characters attempting to help her. Point 7. Bryke arbitrarily implemented Korra and Asami's relationship last minute because they wanted brownie points from the LGBT community, but also didn't want to suffer financial consequences from the potential backlash. This is not true, as explained in Brian Konietzko's Tumblr blog. Hints regarding Korra and Asami's developing romantic relationship were made apparent as early as the beginning of Season 3. It was Brian and Mike's uncertainty of Nickelodeon's reaction that made them hesitant to make their depiction more explicit. Book 5. Point 1. Making Rava and Vatu a counterpart of God and Satan ruined the nuance of the Civil War. I explained how the Civil War in Season 2 was never nuanced, as its conflict was presented to the viewer as being objectively black and white. Thus, the order versus chaos nature of Rava and Vatu's conflict was not inconsistent with the Civil War. Point 2. Harmonic convergence and other lore additions were unnecessary. This is an inconsistent standard, as The Last Airbender established a world rich with lore and backstory, and The Legend of Korra, being a sequel, is allowed to expand upon that world. Point 3. Season 2 emulates fanfiction by not increasing tension by working with character relationships. This is not true. Tension is escalated by character relationships, such as Unalaq's intention to harm Korra's father. Additionally, it is ignorant to say fanfiction does not escalate tension through character relationships. Point 4. Killing a villain is the only way The Legend of Korra knows how to make things feel climactic. This is not true, as Unalaq is the only main villain that is killed. Point 5. Korra not closing the portals is a symptom of the show having contradictory philosophies. This is not true, as there is no longer any reason for Korra to keep the portals closed now that Vatu is no longer imprisoned within the Tree of Time. Point 6. The beginning of Season 2 alludes that the consequences of Korra's poor upbringing at the hands of the White Lotus will be explored, but it doesn't get explored. This is not true, as Korra's difficulty accessing the spirit world is thanks entirely to her poor upbringing in the custody of the White Lotus. Book 6. Point 1. Zaheer's sudden mastery of airbending was contrived. I explained how, given Zaheer's background as being educated on the air nomads and a master martial artist, it was believable for Zaheer to be able to skillfully apply his newfound airbending. Point 2. Zaheer is stupid because he was proven wrong. I explain how it would have been weird for Zaheer, the villain, to be proven right. Point 3. Zaheer's ability to fly wasn't impressive because the Sky Bison do it all the time. I explain how Zaheer isn't a Sky Bison. Point 4. Zaheer's ideology and speeches might have been ripped off from Senator Armstrong from Metal Gear Rising. This marks the moment when Lily begins to take a plunge off the deep end and starts to treat speculation like criticism. I also explain how Senator Armstrong doesn't even appear to be an anarchist. Point 5. The writers put Korra through painful situations for no reason other than to make softcore torture porn. This is speculation, and I explain how it's also fairly unfounded speculation because showing Korra's torture at the hands of the Red Lotus serves a purpose in the narrative and her overall character development. Point 6. There was too much focus put on bending fights. This is a contradiction to a point made in Book 3, where Lily complains that too much focus is put on the world's modernization and overall shift away from bending. Point 7. Pali's combustion bending was too prominent. This is not true, as the math says that Pali's combustion bending only takes up barely 0.16% of the series. Point 8. Character moments were barren and empty. This is an opinion. It's fine if Lily has this opinion, but it doesn't make for a valid criticism of the show, especially since she did not provide any examples or suggestions for improvement. Point 9. The season did not have an interesting plot. This, once again, is another opinion, and it too was not explained. Point 10. Su Yen's characterization is inconsistent. I explain how it has been repeatedly shown through Su Yen's actions and the words of others that it is in Su Yen's character to be hypocritical and self-serving. She is 100% in character. Point 11. The side story that describes the budding air nation was dropped after a single episode. This is another contradiction, as book 1 of Lily's video had her complaining that The Legend of Korra did not have plot divergences that were focused on for prolonged periods of time. This episode actually strays away from the serialized nature of the season, yet Lily still complained about it. Point 12. Korra's problems were magicked out of her. This is not true, as I explained that Korra worked through all the problems the Red Lotus left her with after season 3. Book 7. Point 1. Korra doesn't work through her problems. This is not true. The first few episodes of season 4 were almost exclusively dedicated to showing how Korra copes with and overcomes the trauma inflicted on her. Point 2. The meditation scene was meant to convey the message, put yourself in a vulnerable position with your abuser, which is harmful. This scene was written this way because the writers were insecure about how the last airbender's primary demographic was young children. This is speculation at best, and an ignorant misinterpretation at worst. Book 8, Point 1. The Legend of Korra, as a series, is obsessed with trying to prove animation isn't just for kids. This is speculation, and Lily has forwarded no evidence to support it. Seeing that there were many measures the writers could have taken to firmly establish that The Legend of Korra isn't meant for younger audiences, this assertion lacks the substance it needs to be taken seriously. Point 2. The grievances of the Equalists were not adequately shown. This is not true, as explained by this handy-dandy table I made. Point 3. Amon actually had no desire to achieve equality, so there's no use in insisting he was a well-intentioned extremist. He lied about his true motivations. This is not true, as it was Amon's abusive upbringing that gave him empathy for the vulnerable. Point 4. Amon, Unalaq, and Zahir were supposed to be well-intentioned extremists, but they were not because they were liars. Only a third of this statement is true, which is the case of Unalaq. In part 1 of this video series, I mistakenly asserted that Unalaq was a well-intentioned extremist, but that was a mistake. I retract this statement. Point 5. The villain's problems were not shown. This is not true. All the problems of the well-intentioned extremist villains were shown. Point 6. The villain's problems were of their own doing. None of the villain's problems were of their own doing, not even Unalaq's, so I have no clue where this assertion even came from. Point 7. The villains ended up doing more harm than good. I explained how this had to be the case, otherwise villains like Amon, Zahir, and Kuvira wouldn't have even been villains in the first place. Point 8. Wu did not consider giving the Earth Kingdom the privilege to elect its leader out of a genuine belief in freedom. This is not true. Wu specifically states that he has a genuine belief that democracy is the right step forward for the Earth Kingdom. Point 9. The Legend of Korra, by letting its villains enact a degree of positive change on the world, is endorsing extremism. I explain how this is an almost deliberately uncharitable take on the show's overall message. The message is this. Even people motivated by pure intentions can still cause harm in pursuit of positive change. When advocating for similar types of change, consider approaching the topic with moderation to avoid making the same mistakes as the villains. Point 10. Amon, Unalaq, and Zahir's motivations were retconned. A third of this criticism is correct, as Unalaq's intentions were indeed retconned. The same cannot be said for Amon and the Red Lotus. Point 11. After realizing they had not been consistent enough to follow through with the extremism is bad narrative that spans across the series, the writers gave up on nuance and made Kuvira a generic dictator instead of a well-intentioned extremist in the fourth season. This is not true. I'm surprised Lily missed such a fundamental aspect of Kuvira's character. Kuvira was motivated by the patriotic desire to stabilize and modernize the Earth Kingdom, but like Amon and Zahir, the way she went about trying to establish this positive change, via authoritarianism, ended up causing a lot of problems. Point 12. Kuvira does not enact positive change on the world. This is not true. It has been stated and shown that the Earth Empire brought resources to multiple places in the Earth Kingdom and pulled them out of destitution. Point 13. The bad parts of Kuvira's regime were not shown. This is not true. Bolin and Varric run into refugees from the prison camps. Point 14. It should have been a no-brainer for Su Yin to pounce at the opportunity to take the Earth Queen's place after she was assassinated, yet she didn't. This emphasizes a lack of consistency. I explained how Su Yin had no expectations to meet in regard to this issue. Critiquing a leader and having the active desire to take their place are two different actions. Point 15. This scene in episode 3 of season 4 could have been worded better. I mean, I guess I agree with Lily here, but is that really saying much? Point 16. It was stupid for the characters to complain about Kuvira reuniting the Earth Kingdom. It has been explained by myself and the series that there were plenty of valid contentions to hold in regard to Kuvira's regime. Point 17. Su Yin was pro-democracy, which makes her refusal to fill the power vacuum all the more confusing. This is not true. Su Yin does not endorse any kind of political system. She has only been shown to condemn the Earth monarchy. Seeing that she was Zelfu's autocrat, it's safe to say she isn't an advocate for democracy. Point 18. The show presents democracy as the best political ideology without ever explaining why. This is a contradiction to the next point, which is... Point 19. The Legend of Korra does not respect its viewers' intelligence. Funny how Lily made this accusation right after getting mad at the show for not explaining why democracy is better than archaic hierarchical systems. Book 9. Point 1. The Legend of Korra was bad because it isn't a show about characters. It was only about themes. I explained how this isn't the case. The Legend of Korra is a show about characters and themes, and the two are effectively balanced. Point 2. The writers were obsessed with trying to recapture the magic that made The Last Airbender a great show instead of making The Legend of Korra something that can stand on its own. This is speculation, and the evidence used to support this speculation is insufficient. Additionally, this directly contradicts some statements that were made in earlier parts of Lily's video, such as these.
Would it have really been so horrible to have Korra go through a similar journey to Aang, but with new characters and setups? Remember, Aang's journey wasn't just about learning the elements. There was a war on top of it, necessitating that he master the elements faster than any Avatar ever had before. In The Legend of Korra, there is no journey, so the story has to stand up entirely on its villains. In The Last Airbender, bending was more than just combat. It was art. There was a lot of effort put into the styles of each form of bending and all of its subforms as well. The four elements all drew from real-world martial arts, meaning that every different kind of bender moves differently. During season 2, Iroh teaches Zuko about how he discovered a firebending technique to redirect lightning by studying the waterbenders, and teaches the value of incorporating the spiritual aspects of different bending styles into one's own. It's also about being resourceful. Toph is the first person to discover metal bending because her seismic sense is so attuned that she can feel the impurities in her metal cage, and she's the only one to think, I wonder if I can bend that. The Legend of Korra takes all this detail, rolls it up into a ball, and then throws it in the fire so that they can wank off shitty 1920s technology some more.
Book 1.
The Legend of Korra was serialized instead of episodic like The Last Airbender.
Book 2.
Korra didn't learn how to respect the Avatar state like Aang did. She also doesn't go through a similar Avatar journey like Aang. The show also has to rely on its villains, which The Last Airbender didn't have to do.
Book 3.
The Last Airbender had so much detail put into the concept of bending, but The Legend of Korra shits all over that detail so they can focus on 1920s technology.
Book 9.
The Legend of Korra is trying too hard to be The Last Airbender.
Ah, I see what you're doing. You're going for the insanity defense. Smart.
Point 3. The villains were reskins of Ozai. This is a lie. Lily knows not a single villain was an Ozai reskin because she spent the previous 3 books describing the details of each villain's unique politics and ambitions. Point 4. Season 3 was bad because the writers consciously chose to fill it with explosions and bending fights instead of a story. This is a lie. Lily knows Season 3 had a plot because she spent the first part of her 6th book giving her audience the rundown of the season's plot. Point 5. The pro-bending segments were bad because they didn't explore the conflict. This is a contradiction to a point made earlier in the book, where Lily praises The Last Airbender for focusing on its characters more than its plot. Point 6. The Team Avatar in The Legend of Korra is just a clone of the Team Avatar in The Last Airbender. This is not true. I made some lovely Venn diagrams that illustrate the very few similarities and abundance of differences between the two Team Avatars. The Afterword. Point 1. The Legend of Korra was obsessed with creating more meme faces, because the creators mistakenly believed the usage of exaggerated facial expressions was what made The Last Airbender successful. This particular shot comes off as desperate. This is speculation once again, and I explained how it was unfounded speculation. Anime is practically famous for its usage of exaggerated facial expressions. Lily would need stronger evidence if she wants to insist things like this are proof that the writers were fixated on cloning The Last Airbender. Point 2. Some of the supporting characters are direct descendants of characters from The Last Airbender. This choice in character design suggests the creators were attempting to recapture the magic of the previous series instead of doing anything original. This is speculation and an inconsistent standard. Several pieces of sequel media contain elements and characters from its predecessors. That's almost what it means to be a sequel in the first place. Point 3. The Legend of Korra is cliché. I didn't address this in my actual response, so I'll present my counter-argument here. While it isn't directly acknowledged or explored within the show, there's another theme that definitively characterizes The Legend of Korra: the bucking of tradition. First off, Korra, the protagonist, is a woman. A shredded woman, at that. A shredded colored woman. A shredded colored bisexual woman. In fact, she was the first LGBT protagonist to ever be featured in a Western animated children's program. But this isn't just the first animated children's show with an LGBT protagonist, but the first animated children's show with an LGBT character in it at all. It's a children's show that depicts unorthodox relationships. It's a children's show that seemingly goes out of its way to show women in a whole array of positions, both empowered and docile. It's a children's show that explores complex themes. It's a children's show with antagonists that are morally gray, antagonists that are bestowed humanity by their sympathetic plights, not senseless villainy. I can't name a single other children's show that makes so many bold moves that actively disrupt the media status quo we have here in the West. The Legend of Korra isn't only not cliché, it's revolutionary. And it's laughable to suggest otherwise. Whew, that's that. Took longer than I expected, but let's go ahead and take a look at the cold, hard numbers now. Altogether, there were 86 points made throughout Lily's video. 24.5 of those points were countered with an explanation or argument from yours truly. 8 of those points were subjective opinions. 6 of those points were baseless, unproven speculation, mostly in regard to the author's intent. 4.5 of her arguments contradicted each other. 2.5 of those criticisms were not fairly applied across the board. I'm going to skip this category for a second because I want to save it for last. And finally, 5.16 of those points did not fall into any of the aforementioned categories, which makes them legitimate problems with the show. Alright, let's go back to this one right here. Factual inaccuracies and lies. They take up 35.32 of the 86 total points made. That's 41% of the entire video. The first and last columns are acceptable, but it's these I want to focus on here. This is unacceptable coming from a piece of with this many views made by somebody with this many subscribers. No wonder the like to dislike ratio has been turned off. No wonder comments have to be approved before they appear under the video. Any attentive viewer of the show knows that literally 65% of this video is bad faith bullshit.
Lily Orchard's The Legend of Korra is garbage and here's why is an insult to the art of media analysis. It is an example of what not to do. It's one thing to make a piece of media criticism that's simply full of opinions I don't agree with. In fact, I wouldn't have even responded to it if that's all this video had been. But it's a whole nother ballgame to make a piece of media criticism that is so utterly riddled with contradiction, speculation, inconsistent standards, factual inaccuracies, and blatant lies. What motivated Lily to be so dishonest in this critique? That, shipmates, is something I simply cannot answer. My best guess is that she was expecting this show to be more Avatar, and when she discovered that it wasn't, she got mad. Despite its excellent production quality, despite the fact that it blows several other animated series out of the water, The Legend of Korra is doomed to live in its predecessor's shadow,
where its every mistake is amplified to an uncharitable degree. The majority of Lily's criticisms are utter crap. But does that mean there aren't more criticisms that can be weighed on The Legend of Korra? Does this make it a nigh-flawless show? Of course not. I actually have a few criticisms of my own that I'll address in my next video. Maybe I'll call it, The Legend of Korra Isn't a Masterpiece, but here's how I think it could be. A bit of a mouthful, but I think it got the point across nicely. As the title would imply, I will not only be going into my own criticisms, but also how they can be fixed. I hope you shipmates will stick around and watch that whenever it comes out. So what is there to learn from all of this? And by this I mean, well, this. This project I've spent about half a year on. The lesson is not to take everyone's word at face value. When I first watched this video several months ago, I had the choice to gullibly believe Lily's assessment of this show or go watch it for myself. If I had done the former, I would have been an absolute fool. I would have gotten duped, conned, and then I probably would have gone around and proliferated the same bullshit I've been fed. And while I think I've reasonably justified my arguments, don't let this happen the other way around. Don't take my word for it either. If you haven't already, go watch the show for yourself. Come to your own conclusion. I may seem a little worked up, but it's not because I've grown to absolutely adore this show over the course of the months I've worked on this response series. I'm angry because content that is this lazy, this deceitful, this manipulative, is undeserving of any other reaction. I love art, and I think every piece of art deserves proper criticism from a good faith critic. And as she has demonstrated here, Lily isn't one of those critics, and she deserves to be called out for it. The Legend of Korra is not a garbage show. Lily Orchard is just a garbage critic. There's only one thing left for me to do. I'm going to bed.